Hello students, looking at current affairs for 23rd May, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 12. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Prime Minister announces 1000 crore aid for Bengal. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced a rehabilitation package of 1000 crore for West Bengal and 500 crore for Orissa after an aerial survey of the devastation caused by Cyclone Amphan. In addition to this, the Prime Minister has also announced 2 lakh rupees will be given from the Prime Minister's relief fund to family of the deceased and 50,000 for seriously injured. West Bengal state government has also announced relief and rehabilitation package of 1000 crore and a compensation package too. It is of 2.5 lakh to families of the deceased. Then next is RBI cuts repo rate again down to 4%. So RBI further reduced the key interest rate, that is the repo rate, by 40 basis points on 22nd May. The Monetary Policy Committee had an out of turn meeting. It meets once every 2 months, but now you can see repo rate has again been cut. The last cut we had seen was in mid-April, and now in mid-May again we are seeing a repo rate cut. So there is an out of turn meeting. The previous one you can see here. So here the repo rate was kept unchanged, and now it has come down to 4%. So this has been announced, you can see, and this is in the context of COVID-19 pandemic induced lockdown, which is severely affecting the economy. So Monetary Policy Committee of RBI is a 6-member body. You should know about it. There are 6 members in it, and 3 are from RBI, 3 are from the government, and they together decide the repo rate. Till before that, Before the present government came to power in 2014, before that this was done by RBI on its own. But now it is collaboratively done, you can see. 3 members from RBI, 3 members from government. They are experts, economic experts too. So this 6-member committee decided to reduce the repo rate to 4%, and in this the decision is taken by majority. And of course the chairman is the RBI governor, and he has the casting vote too. So here the 5 members actually in the panel voted for the steep cut of 40 basis points to bring down the repo rate to 4%, while 1 member, Chetan Ghati, voted for a 25 basis points cut. Also the stance remains accommodative, means we'll have accommodative stance, means that further rate cuts if required to boost the economy would be undertaken. RBI Governor Shaktikant Das also termed the risk to growth outlook as gravest. So the economy is going to go down. Central bank refrained from giving a projection of GDP growth. Every time RBI actually gives a projection of GDP growth, what percentage growth India would see for every financial year. But this time it stopped short of that, but said the growth is expected in the negative territory, with some pickup in growth impulses for the second half of 2020-21 onwards. Also, RBI has said that inflation target has also been held back, means RBI Monetary Policy Committee actually decides repo rate based on inflation targeting. Inflation has to stay at 4% with plus minus 2% leeway allowed. But this time we will see that that Monetary Policy Committee has said that inflation would not be the target presently. That target has been suspended for some time. So this is there. Also, RBI said that the economic situation is grave because top 6 industrialized states, which account for 60% of industrial output, are largely in red or orange zones. So this collapse in demand is also there, which has been seen across both urban and rural sectors. So this is there. And here you can see, since February 2019, RBI has reduced the repo rate by cumulative 250 basis points from 6.5% to 4%. So here you can see, this is the repo rate, and blue line shows the reverse repo rate. So repo rate, you should understand, is the rate at which it stands for repurchasing option, the rate at which interest rate which RBI pays, banks have to pay to RBI as such. So that is the repo rate. RBI purchases government securities from banks at this rate. So that is, and reverse repo rate is actually the rate at which government buys, and this is the interest rate which it will have to pay. So, where RBI is demanding less interest rate from banks, means it is providing more liquidity in the economy and giving a boost to the banking system. So, that's there. And this is the revival plan which RBI has announced. So interest on working capital will be converted to term loan. This has been announced. Even the moratorium on interest has been extended. RBI had put a moratorium on repayment of loans, term loans. So that moratorium was for 3 months from 1st March 2020 to 25th May. But now since lockdown has been further extended, it has been seen RBI has given extended this moratorium on repayment of term loans by another 3 months. So it will go on till 31st August 2020. Also, the loans will not be classified by lenders and as non-performing, and they will not be having any impact on the individual credit score. Also, the interest payment deferment for working capital loans has also been undertaken. So, interest payment can also be deferred by another 6 months. So, here you can see the details are also provided. You can see interest on working capital can be converted to a term loan, and banks group exposure limit has been increased to 30% so that banks can provide more loans. And 15,000 crore liquidity facility has been provided for Exim Bank, which is Export Import Bank, and has been this liquidity facility has been extended by up to 90 days. Then next is India reaches out to Pakistan to fight locusts. So India has reached out to Pakistan to counter the locust invasion, which threatens to destroy crops and undermine food security in South and Southwest Asia. So India has proposed a trilateral response in partnership with Pakistan and Iran to combat the desert locust, which is sweeping across the Afro-Asian region. India says it can facilitate supply of malathion, which is a pesticide, to Pakistan. So, typical locust swarm actually varies from less than 1 square kilometer to several hundred square kilometers. And even 1 square kilometer swarm contains 40 million locusts, which in a day can eat as much food as 35,000 people, assuming each individual consumes 2.3 kg of food per day. So, Pakistan has not responded to India's request yet, but we are talking of a partnership with Pakistan and Iran to tackle, because these swarms of locusts are coming from African region into West Asia and then into India through Pakistan. But then officials also say that there are two routes. One locust swarm can travel over a land corridor passing over the West Asian countries and then from Pakistan entering into India. And another one can pass over the Indian Ocean and directly attack farms in peninsular India. So threat is significant. And India and Pakistan actually have a regular mechanism. They have locust officers who hold 6 annual border meetings between June and November. But then locust attacks in the last recent years have not taken place. Last year in 2019, we saw how a locust attack took place after many years. And this year again, the threat is there. And it has already made an attack. We saw yesterday how in Rajasthan locust attack took place, and now locust swarms attack crops in Madhya Pradesh also. They have entered from Rajasthan into Madhya Pradesh. 6 swarms of locusts entered into Madhya Pradesh. But it is said they caused minimal crop damage so far because fields lie fallow after the rabi crops have been harvested. This is the first such invasion in Madhya Pradesh, it is said, since 1992-93. And at that time also swarm was much smaller. This time it was bigger. So, locusts are actually grasshoppers who travel long distances. Then next is, airlines make Arogya Setu app mandatory. So, all airlines have made government's contact tracing app Arogya Setu a prerequisite for booking a flight, despite concerns over privacy and data surveillance due to ambiguities in center's guidelines. So, center has given guidelines, but there are ambiguities. Center said that we'll resume air travel from May 25th. And passengers, the guidelines have been provided. Passengers will have to fill an online health declaration before being issued an online boarding pass. So that is fine. And but the preface of the guidelines issued on May 21 by the ministry say that either you fill the Arogya Setu app or a self-declaration form. But then the airlines have been given guidelines, measures which have been suggested to airlines, to airports. In this, the Ministry of Civil Aviation says that if passenger does not have the app, Arogya Setu app, when she reaches the airport, then passenger should be facilitated to go to a counter provided by the airport where Arogya Setu app can be downloaded. So this brings in ambiguities, though the Minister of Civil Aviation Hardeep Puri had clarified that if you don't have the app or the phone instrument is not compatible, it does not mean that you will be deprived of air travel. You will be given a self-declaration form to fill. But these ambiguities have resulted in airlines now mandating that Arogya Setu app has to be downloaded so that later there are no hassles. So this is regarding air travel now. Various airlines have made downloading Arogya Setu app mandatory. Then next is visa travel curbs relaxed for limited category of OCIs. So visa and travel restrictions were relaxed by the Union Home Ministry for limited category of stranded overseas citizens of India card holders to come to the country. So this is actually, they are given lifelong visa, but this was temporarily suspended in March 2020 in the wake of COVID-19. So categories of overseas citizens of India who have people who are sick here, or they have family members who have died, or they are children who are studying abroad. So such OCIs can come to the country. So they actually feel discriminated too. Several OCIs say they have been stopped from flying to India on the special flights which were arranged by the government under Vande Bharat mission, which were for Indians abroad. So OCIs actually are not Indians. They do not have Indian passport, but they are overseas citizens of India. What does it mean? Also, we'll see in detail. Also, there's another terminology, PIOs, people of Indian origin. What is the difference? We'll see. So, it can see. So, on May 7, Ministry of Home Affairs has issued an order prohibiting international travel to and from 107 immigration checkposts until further orders. So, these travel restrictions are there on international travel, but they will not apply to any aircraft bringing back specific categories of OCI card holders who are stranded abroad. So this OCI scheme actually was initiated in 2005. It provides lifelong visa, an exemption from registration with foreigners, regional registration office, and parity with NRIs in economic, financial, and educational fields, except in purchase of agricultural properties, political and public employment rights. So these are OCIs, you can see. So there was demand for dual citizenship. So instead of dual citizenship, what was announced on Pravasi Bharatiya Divas in 2006 was OCI status. So OCI card. It is not a substitute for Indian visa, but the passport has to display the lifetime visa which will be carried by OCI card holders. So there is a terminology called PIO too. So they are also foreign citizens. These are also foreign nationals. But these are OCIs, are people who are eligible to become citizens of India, who are eligible to become citizens, or they are children of such eligible citizens. So, you know, if the applicant had ever been a citizen of Pakistan or Bangladesh, he cannot become an OCI. Similarly, here also you have exceptions for PIOs too. So, except nationals of Pakistan, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, China, Iran, Bhutan, Sri Lanka and Nepal. So, they can be people of Indian origin. So, PIO is a person whose one parent, grandparent, great-grandparent was born and was a permanent resident of India. Or even if a spouse is a citizen of India, then the person becomes PIO. There are various benefits which they get, like we saw for OCIs too. They do not have to register as such. So they are given lifelong visa, exempted from registration at FRRO. So they have been granted all rights. They also enjoy parity with the economic, financial, educational benefits. So all future benefits that would be exempted to NRIs are available to PIO card holders too. And PIO card holders don't even require a visa. They get a lifelong visa, OCI. PIOs do not require a visa to visit India for a period of 15 years from the date of the issue of PIO card. Even the exempted OCIs are exempted from police reporting too, for any length of stay in the country. So these are foreign citizens, these are foreign nationals eligible to become citizens of India. Then next is 80% success chance for Oxford trials. So Serum Institute of India is the world's largest manufacturer of vaccines by volume and is working on several COVID-19 vaccine candidates. So it is expected to potentially mass produce the Oxford University vaccine. So, it is said there is 80% chance of success for the Oxford vaccine, which is based on a tried and tested platform. So, this has been licensed by University of Oxford to drug maker AstraZeneca, but Serum Institute of India is also associated with it and it is in talks to mass produce the vaccine, which is presently we have seen it is going to clinical trial. There are other vaccines also which have been developed, like US biotech company Codagenix, US rival of Serum, Novavax, Austria's Themis, they are also potentially manufacturing COVID-19 vaccine candidates and Serum has partnered with them too. So Serum Institute of India, you should know, is world's largest manufacturer of vaccines by volume. Then next, it's a private company. Then next is hydroxychloroquine cover extended to frontline workers. So Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has recommended the use of hydroxychloroquine now for asymptomatic frontline workers too. So earlier it was as a prophylaxis used by healthcare workers, but now it is for all asymptomatic frontline workers like surveillance workers, paramilitary, police personnel who are involved in COVID-19 related activities. So they should take hydroxychloroquine as a precautionary measure. So previous advisory was on April 23. So it had placed high risk population. Asymptomatic healthcare workers and asymptomatic household contacts of laboratory confirmed cases to take hydroxychloroquine as a chemo. It's a chemical, chemo prophylaxis. But now it has been extended to frontline workers too, because studies have shown that those who take hydroxychloroquine are less likely to develop the infection. So the frequency and of occurrence as such of COVID-19 is reduced. Then here is the detail of the recommendations which have been given, like who would be eligible, who would be given as such the hydroxychloroquine as a prophylaxis. So these are healthcare workers, frontline workers, and even household contacts. But then there are precautions also, because it said drug should be discontinued if it causes cardiovascular side effects. It should not be used by children under 15 years of age, not for pregnant women, and it should be undertaken under strict medical supervision with informed consent. The next is China scraps GDP target, hikes defense spending. So China has for the first time in 30 years scrapped announcing an annual GDP target, and underline the severe economic challenge facing the world's second largest economy. So China's economy actually contracted by 6.8%, which was minus 6.8% in the first quarter. And this was the first contraction since the end of the Cultural Revolution in 1976. So China has stopped announcing annual GDP target. We saw even RBI above. It did not announce the GDP projections. It said it would be in the negative. So similarly, China is also in the negative. So, country is also facing huge economic challenges because of the slowdown at home too and collapse of external demand too. So, the policy priority, it says now, is to look into job creation. There are widespread job losses which are being announced, as which are being seen, and that's why China has also announced a target of 9 million new jobs in 2020. China also said that its defense spending would be hiked at a lesser percentage. It was 7.5% increase in defense spending in 2019. It will be down to 6.6% increase. Means they will still be spending more on defense, but at a less percentage. So this will result in military budget coming to a lesser amount. And also regarding defense, you should know China unveiled its first homegrown aircraft carrier in 2019. And two more are being constructed by it. So defense expenditure is high in China. China in 2019 also unveiled its most advanced intercontinental ballistic missile, ICBM, Dongfeng 41, with an estimated range of 14,000 kilometers, capable of reaching US too. So here you can see, this is Dongfeng 41, a three-stage missile, nuclear missile, which can reach US. The latest in the Dongfeng series. Dongfeng 31 had 7,200 kilometer range, this has 14,000 kilometer range. Then next is, China seeks India's support for legislation. So we had seen how China is pushing for a legislation in Hong Kong, a new national security law, and now it has sent a demarche to India too and other countries, explaining the reason for this draft legislation and calling this to be an internal matter of the country, and it is aimed at containing the secessionist forces in the former British colony of Hong Kong. So, which is grave threat, it says, to its nation's security. So, it's purely China's internal affair. No foreign country should interfere in this matter, is what China seeks to put forth. Then next is, will exit Open Skies Treaty, announces USA. So, US has given a notice that it will exit the Open Skies Treaty, which is an agreement which allows countries to monitor signatory countries' arms development by conducting surveillance flights over each other's territory. So this is a treaty which had 34 signatories, and it came into effect in 2002. Actually, it was being proposed and it was signed also in 1992. It was first proposed in the early years of the Cold War in 1950s by former US President Dwight Eisenhower. But then finally it came and was finalized and signed in 1992 during George W. Bush presidency when Soviet Union collapsed. But then it came into effect a decade later further in 2002 under George, and this was his father George H.W. Bush when it was signed, and George W. Bush administration when in 2002 when it came into effect. So unarmed reconnaissance flights over the territory of treaty countries is allowed, and US is said to have used this treaty more intensively than Russia, flying flights over Russia. But then USA has now said that it will be exiting this because it says Russia has been on dishonoring and continuously violating the treaty. So sometimes Russia does not allow flight movements, but Russia on its part said it will honor its commitments under the treaty even after US withdraws. We have seen last year also in 2019, USA had exited from another arms treaty which the West had with Russia, which was Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty. So also there is another treaty which is due to expire in as such, which is New START Treaty, which was signed between Obama administration and Russia. So it caps Russian and US nuclear arsenal, and this is also going to expire next year in Feb 2021, but State Department has told US Congress that it is not going to go ahead. It seems unlikely that it will go ahead because State Department says that China's nuclear stockpile is a huge concern. So if New START Treaty continues as it is without China, it makes no sense. So it is not going to go ahead with it too. It wants China on board too. So this is regarding various different, you can see, military treaties which are there. The Open Skies Treaty, the members are shown here. You can see US, Russia and other European countries. This is Kazakhstan. There are 34 member countries. And this is the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty, which USA opted out in 2019. It was signed in 1987, came in force in 1988 between USA and Soviet Union, now present day Russia. So it was prompted by US Russian missiles, Soviet missiles with long range. So US responded as such, and it also deployed its own missiles. But then Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty did was it prohibited all ground-launched cruise missile and ballistic missiles in intermediate range, means range between 500 to 5,500 kilometers. So they are prohibited. So, but then this treaty has no sunset provision when it would end. It also provided for on-site inspections, which ended in 2001. And in 2019, US opted out of it. And this is regarding the New START Treaty. So START stands for Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty. So it START ended, and then New START treaty has been signed between Obama administration and Russian government. So this treaty limits US and Russian strategic warheads to 1,550. It calls for 30% reduction from current limits. And even launchers like missile launchers, etc., they also have to be reduced to 50% from current limits. ICBMs, etc. So this is the New START treaty and provides for inspection to verify compliance too. But this treaty will also expire in Feb 2021, and this is the detail given about US withdrawing from Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty. Earlier it threatened, and then finally it ended up withdrawing, because you can see Russia has been launching nuclear missiles, so it has been testing nuclear missiles. So, Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty bans cruise missiles with range between 500 and 5,500 kilometers. And this was a Russian nuclear missile, you can see, with a range of 2,000 kilometers. And this, you can see, is the detail regarding INF treaty pullout. So, US alleged that new Russian cruise missile Novator violates the pact. But Russia denied the allegation, saying that the missile range is well within the pact's limit. So there was difference in interpretation. But then this warheads as such in the world, you can see over 90% of warheads are in the arsenal of US and Russia. They account for 90% of warheads. 15,000 are nuclear warheads. and 9,600 are in military service too. So this was, you can see, first it was strategic arms limitation talks, then came the strategic arms reduction treaty 1, and then New START, which came in 2010. It put a limit on number of ICBMs, etc. It did not say no ICBM should be manufactured. So there was difference in interpretation, and USA opted out. So that is it. There's difference in interpretation, and US accuses Russia of violating the pact, and Russia says they have not. But US opts out of the treaty. Russia has not left. US is left. So that is it. Thank you.